Airports are places where lots of pieces of engineering come together. Different focuses are needed to design terminals, landside accessibility, equipment, airside logistics, and the topic of this video, runways. As an example for runway design, I will use the newest runway of Amsterdam Airport Schiphol, the Polderbaan. A crucial step in finding the optimal spot to build a new runway is estimating the needed dimensions, the width and mainly the length of the runway. Assuming world's largest operating passenger aircraft, the Airbus A380, needs to be able to take off and land on this new runway, we can safely assume that it needs to be at most 15,000 feet long and 300 feet wide, plus the needed space for taxiways, of course. These numbers are a function of many different variables, including wind speed and direction, altitude, local temperature, and the already mentioned aircraft type. Now, a spatial analysis of the airport needs to be made. Considering that aircraft need to taxi between runway and terminal before and after flight, creating a short route between the two would be preferable, since that will decrease travel time and emissions of CO2 and NOx, and increase passenger experience. Of course, a runway intersecting another runway can't be used optimally, so that should be avoided if possible, and the same holds for runways built too close to one another. Obstacles near the airports like highways, mountains, which we don't have in Holland, and entire cities are something important to evaluate as well. Not only are cities avoided for collision purposes, also a reduction of noise and air pollution are reasons to diverge from towns as well. Considering Schiphol's layout, several options are possible. Most, however, can be neglected because of towns, pieces of nature, and highways nearby. Also, the fact that strong winds from the southwest are not uncommon in the Netherlands rule out several options, since operating with crosswinds is not advisable. Schiphol decided that the Polderbaan should be constructed over here, with long, long taxi times as a result. Once the location has been determined, internal design of the runway is the next thing to consider. Runways, usually made from asphalt or concrete, can be optimized by creating a runway gradient, not really possible in this flat country, or a porous pavement. The width of the runway usually has three sections: the runway itself, the shoulders, and a safety area. The first two are usually paved, while the latter is normally, well, just grass. All three are direct functions of the airplanes expected to use the runway. The dimensions I put on screen are the minima for airplanes in Design Group 6, which covers the needs for the A380. To assist pilots, two features are added to runways: lightings and markings. You will always see a set of green lights indicating the start of the runway and a set of red lights marking the end. Both are accompanied with a flashing light on either side of them and threshold markings just before or just after the lighting. Runway edge lights are added to mark the side of the runway. These are colored white at the start of the runway, but turn into yellow when less than 2,000 feet and half of the runway is left. The last 500 feet of the runway will be indicated by red lights. A similar coloring system is used for the centerline lights, which, together with the centerline markings, have the function to help pilots align the plane with the runway. This, together with finding the optimal landing spot, is the key part for an arriving aircraft. This optimal landing spot is indicated with four longitudinal lines on both sides of the centerline, with a similar marking placed 500 feet before and 500 feet after that. The final remarkable marking you'll see on runways are the big numbers at the start. These indicate the direction of the runway. 36 means heading north, 09 indicates east, 18 means heading south, and 27 equals west. A simple but clear system for naming runways. But it is also ambiguous when multiple runways are parallel with each other, as it is, for example, in the case of Schiphol. This can be solved by adding an L for left, a C for center, or an R for right to these numbers. And of course, if a runway is designed to be used in two directions, lightings and markings need to be added for both directions. The discussed lightings and markings are usually accompanied with other signs, equipment, and possibly even more lightings and markings. Whether it be for the new runway of Schiphol or for any other airfield, lots of parameters and considerations are involved in designing a runway. Oh, and by the way, did you know that Schiphol is actually pronounced as Schiphol in Dutch? Yeah, Dutch legend by Mr. Engineering Guy.